Good morning, everyone. I welcome all of you to yet another lecture from the course System Modeling and Simulation. Today, I am going to explain Module 3. Actually, Module 3 consists of two chapters, Random Number Generation and Random Variate Generation. So, first in this part, that is part 1, I will be dealing with Random Number Generation. The contents of this chapter or the module or this lecture is as follows. So first I will be telling about properties of random numbers. Second, generation of pseudo random numbers. In particularly in this, I will be explaining about problems that occur during generation of pseudo random numbers. And second is considerations while selecting methods or routines for generating random numbers. The third topic is techniques for generating random numbers. Mainly I will be discussing four techniques: linear congruential generators, mixed congruential generators, multiplicative congruential generators, and combined linear congruential generators. The fourth topic, which is our final topic, is tests for random numbers. There are two types of tests: frequency test. In this frequency test, we'll be dealing with Kolmogorov-Smirnov test and chi-square test. The second test are a test for independence, that is a autocorrelation test. So what are the objectives of this lecture? The objectives would be to apply different methods for generating random numbers and to apply frequency test and independence test for checking uniformity and independence of random numbers. So let us start with the first topic. So random numbers are basic ingredients in the simulation of almost all discrete event simulation systems, right? We know about that. So most computer languages have a routine, a subroutine object or a function that will generate a random numbers. You take any standard language, it will have a built-in function to generate random numbers. So what are the properties? The first topic is the properties of random numbers. There are two important properties of random numbers. One is uniformity, another is independence. When the sequence of random numbers, for example, from R1, R2, R2 up to Rn are generated, they should satisfy two important properties. Two statistical properties. What are those two statistical properties? Are uniformity is the first property and the second one is independence, right? So we know already, like, the random number, as in the independent sample drawn from a continuous uniform distribution CDF, will be between 0 and 1, right? So one, if the number is between 0 and 1, if it is below 0 and above 1, it is 0, right? F of x. This is a CDF, that is a continuous distribution function, right? So the PDF, whatever I was telling, is given in the diagrammatic form like this. So that means f of x will fall from 0 to 1, right? That means f of x will be 1, or it will be 1 bit, or it will be between 0 to 1. Whenever the f of x is between 0 to 1, the f of x value will be taken as 1. If it is below 0 and above 1, it is taken as 0 otherwise. This is a PDF function we need to remember. Right? So what are the two important properties I was telling? That is uniform distribution and independence. Right? Uniform distribution is nothing but a probability distribution in which all outcomes are equally likely to occur. That means what? Because we are dealing with random events, right? So random events means what? For example, if I toss a coin, the coin, the outputs of the tossing of coin will be either a head will appear or tail will appear, right? So there is an equal chance of the outcome being coming, right? So uniformity means what? The probability distribution in which all the outcomes are equally likely to come, right? Each variable has some probability that it will occur. A coin also has an uniform distribution because the probability of getting either head or tail in a coin toss is the same, right? And another important property is independence. This is important. Like, this property states that in a given sequence of series of random numbers should not be dependent on its previous numbers. Correct or not? It should not be dependent upon its previous numbers. Okay. That means what? Already head has come. So if I toss the next time the coin, it doesn't mean that the next outcome which is coming, it depends upon the previous outcome. right? That is independence. So in this chapter, in this module, we will be dealing with these two properties in detail. Now, generation of pseudo numbers, pseudo random numbers. So we know already pseudo means false. So false random numbers are being generated. Why we say that the false, actually we are dealing with random number, generation of random numbers. But instead of saying the generation of random numbers, I will be telling now generation of pseudo random numbers. Why pseudo random numbers? Because the numbers are, the random numbers are actually not random in nature. If you speak strictly, they are not random in nature. Why? It means because we are having some method to generate it, right? Some method to generate. That some method means what? It will have some consideration, like the certain method is designed based on something. If it is designed based on something, that is, it is not random in nature. Correct? We may think that they are random, but strictly speaking, they are not random. Right? That's why we call them as pseudo random. You see that the goal of any generation scheme is to produce a sequence of numbers between 0 and 1 which simulates or imitates the ideal properties of uniform distribution and independence. So any random numbers generated, any scheme which generates random numbers should satisfy these two properties. The random numbers generated should always satisfy the two properties. What are the two properties? Uniform distribution and independence. Any scheme to be accepted for generating random numbers should satisfy the two properties. One is uniform distribution, another is independence. We know uniform distribution means any number which is being generated or any outcome which is being getting should have an equal chance of getting. Any number should have an equal chance of getting, right? And independence means what? Any output which is coming or any number being generated should not depend upon the previous number generated or the previous output or the previous outcome, right? So that's why when generating pseudo random numbers, certain problems can occur. Now, instead of random numbers, I am using the word pseudo random number. Why? As I said, we are using some schemes to generate random numbers. That's why we can say that their random numbers are pseudo in nature. They are false random numbers, right? So while generating the pseudo random numbers, we face some problems. What are the problems we face across? So there are some problems. For example, the generated random numbers may not be uniformly distributed. Thus, I said any random numbers being generated should satisfy two important properties. The first one being uniform distribution, the second one being what? Independence property. So what is uniform distribution? There should be a chance for every number to occur. So that itself may not be there. The generated random numbers may not be uniformly distributed. And the second problem being is the generated numbers may be discrete valued instead of continuous value. Sometimes we require continuous value, but the random numbers being generated will be discrete in nature. We want 0.001, 0.0002, 0.003, something like integral. But we may be getting only discrete numbers like 1, 4, 10, 9, 10, 20, like that. The mean of the generated number. So mean, we know this is one of the parameter, right? So the mean of the generated numbers may be too high or too low. We don't want such a mean of any random numbers to be too high or too low. But this may also happen that the mean, whatever we may be getting, might be too high or too low. The variance of the generated numbers may also be too high or too low, right? There may be dependence. Actually, the two important properties is what? Uniformity and dependence. So the numbers what we are generating by the routine might also be dependent, right? The numbers might be, there might be dependence. For example, there might be autocorrelation between the numbers, or the number successively high or low than adjacent numbers. Several numbers above the mean followed by several numbers below the mean. This could be some dependency within the numbers, right? So these are some few problems which are faced during the generation of pseudo random numbers, right? So while generating the random numbers by any routine or by any function, we are considering some of the considerations. If these considerations are satisfied by the any routine, then we'll say we can accept that routine. So what is the first consideration? What we need to keep in our mind is the routine should be fast. That means what? Whichever the routine we are generating should be fast enough to produce the random numbers, right? The routine should be portable to different computers and ideally to different programming language. So whichever the routine we have deployed for generating the random number, it should be portable and it should be ideally can be programmable on different languages. the rotation should be sufficiently long cycle, have a sufficiently long cycle. This means what? Before the repetition of the previous random number generated, there should be a lot of random numbers coming in between. That doesn't mean that previous random number what we got, the same random number is repeated after a few random numbers are there. No. The cycle means what? After generating the one random number, the same random number should not appear immediately. There should be a long gap. The cycle should be what? Sufficiently long. The random number should be replicable. Yeah, after generating one random number, it doesn't mean that that random number should not come. It should be replicable. Most important and as indicated previously, the random generated random numbers should closely approximate the ideal statistical properties of uniformity and independences. Right? These two important properties any rotation should satisfy. What is that two important properties? Uniformity and independence. Now, after completing this, some of the considerations while generating random numbers and few problems faced while generating the pseudo random numbers, we will move to our next topic. So, techniques for generating random numbers, right? So, there are four techniques which are simple to generate random numbers. So, first is linear congruential generators. Another is mixed congruential generator. Another is multiplicative congruential generators. Next is combined linear congruential generators. So, let us see what is the first technique. So, the linear congruential generator states like this. The method is posed by Lehmer in 1951. Which generates the random numbers xi using this formula. What is that? A into xi minus 1 plus c into mod m, right? Where a, c, m are some properly chosen constants. And x naught is the seed. That is the initial value, starting value of the random number. And xi are the random numbers being generated, right? Between 0 to m minus 1. Between 0 to m minus 1, which produce the random numbers ri between 0 to 1, where ri is nothing but xi minus m. Okay. Now, the second method is mixed congruential generator. So, mixed congruential generator is same as the linear congruential generator. Only thing is what? Here, in the linear congruential generator, the value of c can be 0. But if the value of the c cannot be 0, if it is not 0, then the linear congruential method becomes the mixed congruential generator. That's the only difference. Just if the constant is not equal to 0, the same formula or the same method becomes the mixed congruential generator. The fifth being is multiplicative congruential generator. Whenever the value of c is definitely 0, at that time we call this linear congruential generator as multiplicative congruential generator. So let us see one problem or more than one problem based on each of this linear, mixed and multiplicative. The question will be like this. Use the linear congruential method to generate a sequence of random numbers with x naught is equal to 27, a is equal to 17, c is equal to 43 and m is equal to 10. So as given, we have here x naught is the seed initial value and a value is being given, c value is being given. So directly we can substitute in this formula. Xi is equal to a into xi minus 1 plus c mod m, right? Where r random numbers, what is being generated is nothing but xi by m. So what is the a value given? It is 17. Xi minus 1. So what is xi minus 1? I don't have xi minus 1 in particular, but I have x naught. So I will start with the x naught value. So x naught, because if this is x naught, this will become x1. Are you getting me? Because this is xi minus 1, this will be xi. If this is x naught, this is x1. So, I am substituting x naught means what value I am getting? I am getting x1 value, right? So, if I will get 2 as xi. So, therefore, the random number being generated is 2 by 100. It is 0.02. How come 100? Because m value has given as 100. Similarly, x2 means what? This xi will become x1. So, what is the x1 value? We got already 2. X2 is equal to 17 into the previous value 2 plus 43 mod 100. So, I will be getting 77. Therefore, R2 will be 0.77. Similarly, X3 value, I will be getting 42. Therefore, random number is 0.052. Therefore, the random numbers being generated will be between 0 to 1. So, it's very simple method, very simple formula. Even this has been asked many times in exams. So, the another problem, if M is equal to 100, A is equal to 19 and C is equal to C. See, whenever you see C is equal to C, we should come to know it is multiplicative congruential method. Correct term. Same formula, only c is equal to 0. That congruential method is called as what? Multiplicative congruential method. So let us look at this same formula. So we know that what is asking, generate sequence of random. So we know that xi is equal to a into xi minus 1 plus c. So just we are substituting in that and we get x1, x2, x3. So how many we can generate, as many as we want. So I generated 3 by substituting, direct substitution, direct evaluation, right? Let us see the third problem. Using the multiplicative congruential method. See, whenever he use the word multiplicative congruential method, we should come to know c is equal to 0. That is the point you have to remember. So he is not directly telling c is equal to 0, but he is indirectly telling using the multiplicative congruential method, right? Find the period of the generator. What do you mean by period? Period is nothing but the total number of random numbers, where the starting value and the ending value of the random number will be same, right? It is like a cycle. So let us see. So I have given a note here. Period means the number of xi, the number of, not number, number of random numbers from I is equal to 0 to, starting from I is equal to 0 and ending value of xi should be same as whatever we got the xi value for 0 at that point. That is called as the period. So let us put it in the formula. So as we have said, multiplicative congruential method, c will be 0, correct? So I have taken, he has given x naught value, he has given 4 x naught values, 1, 2, 3, 4. That means what? I will separately do x, for x naught is equal to 1, for x naught is equal to 2, for x naught is equal to 3 and for x naught is equal to 4. So what I have done for that purpose, I have tabulated, I have taken I value here like this and xi values are like this. So x naught value what he has given, x naught, this is not now, I value is 0. X naught value what he has given, x naught is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. So x naught is equal to 1, x naught is equal to 2, x naught is equal to 3, x naught is equal to 4. Substituting the values of a and m and x naught in the formula, and c is equal to 0, we need to substitute c is equal to 0 because it is multiplicative congruential method. Once we substitute that, we will be getting these values. We have to go on doing for each method until we get back the same value. So here starting value what we got is 1. So where we got the same value, 1 repeated at 16. So therefore, when x naught is equal to 1, the period will be 16. Similarly, when x naught is equal to 2, I did this continuously until I got 2. So I got 2 when x naught is equal to 8. So therefore, the period will be 8 here. So the period is 8 for when x naught is equal to 2. Similarly, when x naught is equal to 3, so I did the same thing when I got 3 back. So for when x naught is equal to 3 also, the period what I got is 16 because there are 0 to 16 numbers, right? The seed, when the seed is 4, x naught, that is x naught is 4, the sequence what I got is 4 because we got back 4 after 4 points. 1, 2, 3, 4. After 4 itself, we got back the 4. Therefore, the seed will be 4 here, right? Next problem, same as the previous one. A is given, M is given, seed is given. Now generate few random numbers using the formula. C is given, C is equal to 0 means multiplicative congruential. Substitute back and get back the random numbers what we are substituting. Next we will see the test for random numbers. We know already that there are two important properties of any random numbers being generated. One is uniformity, another is independence. So we should check the numbers are uniform and independent. So for that, there are various tests. For checking the uniformity, that is a uniform distribution of the random numbers being generated, we call them as frequency tests. There are frequency tests for checking the uniformity of the random numbers being generated. So out of this frequency test, there are two types of tests which we are going to study now. That is the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test and the chi-square test. For checking the independence of the random numbers, we have autocorrelation test, which will check for the independence of the random numbers being generated. So we'll start with the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, which will check for the uniformity, one of the methods for checking the uniformity of the random numbers being generated. So already we have completed this topic in the module 4. So it's a revision. Here only the degree of freedom will be a little bit different here. Degree of freedom what we calculated there was using alpha minus s minus 1, but here it will be different. So Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, already you know, it compares a continuous distribution with a cumulative distribution function to the empirical continuous distribution function S of m, right? It compares the continuous cumulative distribution function f of x with the continuous distribution, uniform distribution of the empirical continuous distribution s of n of x, right? Of the sample of n with n observations, right? By definition, we know any random number generated being, it should be between 0 to 1, between 0 to 1, right? For example, if the sample from the random number generator is R1, R2 up to Rn, then the empirical cumulative distribution S of n is defined by number of R1, R2 up to Rn divided by n, right? Where n is the large, as n becomes larger, S of n should become a better approximation of f of x, right? If this becomes larger, if there are large values, the S of n will be a better approximation of the f of n, right? So we know already the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. What is the thing first we'll do? First, we'll arrange the random numbers being generated from smallest to largest. That means what? We arrange them in the ascending order. Let Ri denote the ith smallest observation, then R1, R2, R3 up to Rn we generate. Then the second thing we compute I by n minus Ri. After computing I by I minus Ri, we'll find out what is the maximum among the I by n minus Ri. N is the total number of numbers, I being the ith number, right? And Ri being the ith random number, right? I ranges from I ranges from 1 to n. I ranges from 1 to n, right? And Ri is the ith random number. You can see here, I ranges from 1 to n. That means what? The first value of I will be 1 for the first random number. Similarly, we find the next Ri minus I minus 1 by n. And after finding that, we'll find what is the max out of that. That max is, we'll name it as D minus. The maximum out of 1 by n minus Ri, we'll name it as D plus. Then we will compute which is the maximum out of D plus and D minus. That we say it as D. Then after that, after computing the D ourselves, then we will determine the critical value of value DA from the table A dot 8. Are you getting? Actually, this is D alpha. Right, for the specified significance level alpha with the sample size n. If the statistic D is greater than the critical value D alpha, the null hypothesis, the data or the symbol for the uniform distribution is rejected. That is, if the calculated D value is less than D alpha from the table, then we conclude that no difference has been detected between the true distribution of R1 to Rn and the uniform distribution. Right, so let us see a simple problem. Suppose I have taken a simple problem. Suppose this problem has already been asked in exam. Suppose if there are five numbers, random numbers 0.44, 0.81, 0.14, and 0.05, 0.93 were generated, and it is desired to test for uniformity using, we have two tests for testing uniformity. One is Kolmogorov and Smirnov. He says we need to test the uniformity using Kolmogorov-Smirnov test with the level of significance alpha is equal to 0.05, right? So given level of significance is 0.05 and the sample size n is equal to 5. Why n is equal to 5? How I came to know n is equal to 5? Because there are 5 numbers, 5 random numbers given. So as the first step says, we need to arrange them in ascending order. So the first step, we have arranged them in ascending order. Then we will calculate I by n minus Ri. So to calculate I by I minus Ri, first I need to do I by n. So after calculating, so these values I have tabulated here. So Ri, first random number, second random number, third, fourth, fifth, after arriving in ascending order. I value is for first random number is 1 because I ranges from 1 to n. So 1 divided by n. What is n value? N is 5. 1 divided by 5. This is 1 divided by 5. How much 1 divided by 5 will be? 0.020. This value is 1 divided by 2. How much it is? 0.040. Similarly, this is 1 divided by 3. 1 divided by 4, 1 divided by 5. Are you getting? Sorry, this is 1 divided by 5, this is 2 divided by 5. 2 divided by 5. Because I value is 2 and n value is 5. This is 3 divided by 3 divided by 5. Similarly, this is 4 divided by 5. 4. Why? Because I value is 5, 4 because that is the fourth number. 5 means there are totally 5 numbers. Similarly, here this is 5 divided by 5. I will get 1 as the value. 5 divided by 5. So these values we have got. After getting I by n, I will subtract this value from this value because I by n minus r I need to do. 0.20. This value is how much? 0.20 minus 0.05. How much it is? 0.15. Similarly, I will subtract this value from this. So 0.40 minus 0.14. So after getting all these things, now out of this, which is the maximum value we got? The maximum value we got is 0.26. So this will be D plus. Similarly, I need to do I minus 1 by n. I minus 1 by n. What is I value right now? 1. 1 minus 1 is what? 1. Sorry. Ri is, what is Ri? 0.05. Ri value. Minus. What is I value right now? I value is 1 because it is the first thing. 1 minus 1. Right? Divided by n. N value is 5. Correct? Yeah, it's here. So what is this? 0.05, this 1 minus 1 will be 0. 0 by anything is 0. 0.05 minus 0 divided by 5. This is 0 itself. 0.05 minus 0 is 0.05 itself. Similarly, we will do for all those things. Which is the maximum out of this value? That we term it as D minus. So then we will compare D plus and D minus. Which is the maximum out of these two will be our D. So after comparing this two, I think so 0.26 is max out of 0.26 and 0.21. Only these two values we are comparing. Max of D plus and max of D minus. So out of this, whatever the maximum value, that is a D. Right? So this will be our D. What is D? D is nothing but. What is the D value we got? We got it as 0.26. Here I have mentioned. D is nothing but what now? 0.26. Now we got D as 0.26 by the calculation. Now we will check the same value is from the table 8.8 for the given level of significance. The given level of significance is 0.05 and n value is 5 here. So that means what? We will check the value from the table at 0.05 and n value is 5. So let us see the table. So alpha value is here 0.05, n value is 5. So at 0.05 n value is 5, what is the value? 0.565. So, from the table, what we are checking? From the table, we are checking the value of D at a 0.05, the value what we got is 0.565, right? So this value is compared with the value what we calculated. 0.26 is definitely lesser than 0.656. So when we compare this in the ninth step, after comparing, since the computed value is less than the tabulated value, the hypothesis is of no difference between the distribution of the generated numbers and the uniform distribution. Therefore, the uniform distribution is not rejected. So, if the computed value is less than the tabulated value, if the computed value is less than the tabulated value, the hypothesis is not rejected. Right? Because right, if the computed value is lesser than the tabulated value, it is accepted. So that means what? The random numbers what is been given, it will satisfy the property of uniformity. Suppose if we get the calculated value more than the tabulated value, then we say that it is rejected. Then we can conclude that the given random numbers don't satisfy the property of uniform distribution. So similarly, we'll see another method, that is the chi-square test. Chi-square test, already we have done this in the module 4. Again, it's a repetition, but only thing is what, the degree of freedom here will be m minus 1. That is important. We need to consider the degree of freedom at m minus 1. So we know the formula for chi-square test: observed frequency minus expected frequency whole square divided by expected frequency for I is equal to 1 to n. So 1 starts, that's the first number to the last number. So this OI is observed frequency, E is expected frequency, and N is the number of classes, and EI is the expected frequency given by E is equal to N by N. N is the total number of classes, right? Total number of observation, and N is the total number of classes. So let us see how to solve a problem from this. One important point to remember, please remember here, you should not get confused. The degree of freedom here in this module, whatever we are taking, is N minus 1. Right, so the problem will be like this: use the chi-square test with the level of significance alpha is equal to 0.05 to test whether the data shown below is uniformly distributed or not. So see, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10, like this, 1 2 3. So in each row there are 10 numbers. How many rows are there? 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. So like that, 10 rows are there. Totally there are 100 numbers. Are you getting? There are totally how many numbers? 100 numbers. So what I will do, this 100, that means what? Capital N value is 100. There are 100 random numbers. So first I need to divide them into classes, because I need to get small n. Small n is the number of classes, right? This is a little bit different procedure compared to that and this. But the gist is same, right? So what I will do, I will set the 100 numbers out of the set of 100 numbers which has been tested for independence. The first 10 values, I will arrange them from 0.012, I will classify 0.01 to 0.10. Because you see, there are different numbers. We know the random numbers being generated should be between 0 to 1. So 0.01 to 0.10. So how many numbers are there from 0.01 to 0.10? We need to check here. We need to classify 0.01. Yeah, here one number, 0.02 comes under this category, 0.01 to 0.10, right? Similarly, one number is there, next two numbers, 0.05 also will come under that range, two numbers, three numbers. Four numbers. Five numbers. 6, 8, it is the 0.01 to 0.10. 10 is also counted, right? 0. Here also one number is there. So we need to carefully check how many numbers are there under this category. So actually, our random numbers will range from 0 to 1. So what I have done, I have divided, as there are 10 rows with 10 numbers each, I have divided into 10 classes, 0.01 to 0.10. So after observing carefully, between the first interval, what is the first interval? This first interval, I can write this as 0.01 to 0.10. This is the first interval. Similarly, what is the second interval? Second interval will be from 0.11 to 0.20. Next interval will be 0.21 to 0.30. The next interval will be 0.31 to 0.40. The next interval will be 0.41 to 0.50. That is the fifth interval. Now sixth interval will be 0.51 to 0.60. The next interval is 0.61 to 0.70. Similarly, next is 0.71 to 0.80. Next is 0.81 to 0.90. Another one, 0.91 to 1.00. So these are the ranges of intervals, right? So if you observe this, so how many numbers are there within this, from which falls from 0.01 to 0.10 is 8. This is what is the observed frequency. Similarly, how many numbers are there which will fall from 0.11 to 0.20? 8. How many numbers are there which will fall from 0.21 to 0.20 interval is 10. You have to see this carefully and you have to mark this and you have to write. Right. But what is the expected frequency? As we have 100 numbers, we expect and we have divided into 10 classes. We expect every class should have 10, 10, 10, 10. That is expected frequency. We have to write ourselves, right? This is absurd. How many are there? What is expected, right? Now we'll do OI minus EI. So we'll get this answer. Then we'll square this. Then we'll do OI minus EI. So we'll get 3.14. This is a summation actually. Summation. This is a summation symbol, right? That itself is our XI. The summation, right? Yet we got this the value what we wanted. So after that, the value what we got is 3.4. This is compared with the critical value at given alpha. What is given alpha? Given alpha in the question is 0.05. Where it is given? Let me check out. So the given value is 0.05. And what is that n? Alpha comma n. Correct or no? So this n, as I said, we need to check this at n minus 1 degree of. Correct? This is very important. So how n minus 1 we have taken into 10 classes. N is the number of classes, right? N is the number of classes. So how many classes we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So n is what? Number of classes. N is equal to the number of classes. N is equal to 10 here. Small n is equal to 10. That is the 10 classes we have. 10 classes. Correct or no? So after having this 10 classes, right? So the degree of significance we need to remember, that is n minus 1. We need to check at n minus 1. The observation is what? N minus 1. Right? So what is this capital N? Capital N is nothing but the total number of observations. The total number of observations are 100 here. So we'll be checking the degree at n minus 1. So this is Thank you. right? So at alpha and n minus 1, so n minus 1 is 9 and alpha. So what is the value in from the table? The value from the table is 16.9. So how it is? So what is alpha value? 0.05. This is alpha, and this at 9, here it is 16.9. So now we will compare whether the obtained value is lesser than the tabulated value. The obtained value is 3.4 and the tabulated value from the table is 16.9. So therefore it is accepted, right? So we give the conclusion, since S0 is much smaller than the tabulated value, therefore the null hypothesis is not rejected. That is pretty. We conclude now, the calculated value is lesser than the tabulated value, therefore the hypothesis is not rejected. So that is also one of the tests for checking the distribution, that is a chi-square test. So we have seen now two tests for checking the uniformity. One is Kolmogorov, another is what, the chi-square test. Now we will check how to see the independence. So there is one test for our syllabus, that is autocorrelation test for checking the independence. So we'll see the method for this. The autocorrelation test is concerned with the dependence between the numbers. Yes, we know the test computes the autocorrelation between every L numbers. Between every L numbers, this L is also known as the lag, starting with the ith number. Thus the autocorrelation rho of IL between the following numbers would be of interest. Ri plus L, Ri plus 2L. It goes like this up to Ri plus m plus 1 into L. So we'll see what is that m, where m is the largest number such that I plus m plus 1 into L is lesser than or equal to m. So we'll calculate m from this formula only. So for large values of m, the distribution of the estimator of rho IL denoted by rho cap IL is approximately normal. That means what normal distribution it will become. So we need to see the normal distribution table now. So Ri plus L, Ri plus 2L... are uncorrelated. There will be no correlation. Then the test static can be found as follows. So we need to find Z0. Z0 is equal to PIL cap divided by sigma rho IL, which is distributed normally with mean of 0 and the variance is 1 under the assumption of independence of large L. Where what is this rho cap IL is 1 by m plus 1 summation of Ri plus KL into Ri plus K plus 1 L from K0 to M minus 0.25. And what is the sigma? Sigma is this one. So how to check the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis is check for rejection from minus Z alpha by 2 to alpha by 2, right? So I will tell this procedure in a very simple way. So first we need to identify I, L, N, M. What is I? I is the beginning number. We need to remember I is the beginning. L is the lag, that is a gap given, and N is the total number of numbers. And M we will find out, it's the largest number we will find from this formula. So after identifying I, L, N, M, the next step we need to find the rho IL cap using the formula. Rho IL is equal to 1 by M plus 1 into this. Next we need to find a sigma suffix of rho IL cap using the formula. Then we need to calculate Z0 using this formula, that is this divided by this. Then we need to check the whatever the value we got it, whether it is lesser than the value in the table a.0 at alpha by 2, at z alpha by 2. We calculate z naught. We need to compare the value calculated at z naught with the z alpha by 2 from the table a.3. So the same one example I will take. Test whether the third, 8th, 13th and so on numbers in the sequence at the beginning of these sections are autocorrelated. The word itself is saying that autocorrelated, and we have to use that a is equal to 0.05, he says. I think so, it is not a, it is alpha. We need to use a alpha is equal to 0.05. Symbol alpha is equal to what? 0.05. So first step, as it says, we need to identify I, L, N, M. So what is I, I said? I is nothing but the beginning, right? So he says in the question, not the beginning, he says test whether third number, eighth number and 13th number. So he started with the third for autocorrelation. So I will be 3. So what is the gap? The gap is after every five number, right? We'll get 8 after adding 5 to 4, right? That means what? We'll get 13 after a gap of 5. That means what? Every fifth number. So therefore the lag will be 5. From 3, starting from 3, if you want to go to 8, so the fifth number will be 8, correct or no? 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The fifth number will be 8 from 3. That is the lag is small L is what? 5. He has given himself. And what is capital N? Capital N is the total number of numbers given. How many numbers are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are 30 numbers. So capital N is equal to 30. And M we need to find out. M is the largest integer such that I plus M plus 1 into L is lesser than or equal to L. That is, what is I value? 3 plus M plus 1. 1 is the constant. And what is L? Lag is 5. Lesser than or equal to 30. So which is the number which will satisfy this condition? If I substitute 0 here, 3 plus 1 into 5. So 3 plus 8, 8 definitely. M should be the largest number such that it satisfies this. So I think so M I will get 4. If I substitute 4 here, 3 plus 4 plus 1. 4 plus 1 is 5. 5 plus 5 is 5 into 5 is 25. 25 plus 3 is 28. 28 is lesser than or equal to 30, satisfied. If I substitute M as 5, 5 plus 1 is 6. 6 5 is 30. 30 plus 3, 33 will not be lesser than or equal to 30. It should be the largest number which is lesser than or equal to. So the largest number which is lesser than or equal to this condition is 4. If I take 1 also it will satisfy, but 1 is not the largest number. If I take 0 also it will satisfy lesser than or equal to, but 0 is not the largest number. The largest number which is satisfying this condition will be 4. Now according to the formula we need to find rho IL cap. So rho IL cap is simple. So 1 by M plus 1, M we got now 4. So we know k value from 0 to 4 now, because ml is now ri plus kl. So k ranges from 0 to m. So I value is, we know I is 3. Already we got the value of I is 3. So that I am substituting here. So f value we got 4. M value we got 4, I substituted. I value is 3. K value ranges from 0 to 4. So k I am keeping as it is. L value is 5. So I am substituting L value is 5. L is a lag. So I substituted this. After substituting this, then I will expand the summation. So when k is equal to 0, r3 plus k value is 0, 0 into 5 into r3 plus k value is 0, 0 plus 1 into 5. Summation, we need to sum up all these things from k is equal to 0 to 4. Substitute k0, k1, k2, k3, k4, we'll get this. So after doing that, we'll get this r3 into r8 plus r8 into r13 plus r13 into r8, all those things. So what is r3? R3 is the third random number given in the question. So R3 is given as 0.23. Just you can check out. 0.23 is the third number given. So R3 is that. So what is R8? R8 is the eighth number given. So R8 is given as 0.28. So what is R8 here? Eighth number, 0.28. That's what I have substituted here. After substituting this, I will get a minus 0.1945. So what is the value of rho cap of IL we got? Rho cap of I value is 3, L value is 5. Rho cap of 3, 5 is minus 0.1945. Then we'll calculate sigma suffix rho cap of IL. Sigma suffix formula is very simple. 13 root of 13m plus 7 divided by 12m plus 1. So m value is 4, we know. So it's very easy to get this value. So then z naught will be rho divided by sigma, right? Rho cap of IL divided by sigma cap of IL. So you will get this value. So this is obtained value. Now we are comparing this obtained value from the table A3 or the level of significance given. So level of significance given is 0.0. So we will be, sigma by 2 will be 0.025. From the table A.3, the value what you'll be getting is the value what we'll be getting is 1.96. So what we obtained is minus 1.516. What we are getting is 1.96. So we'll be comparing. So definitely the value obtained is lesser than the value in the table. Therefore, we have to accept this test. That means what we have to, it will not be rejected. That means to say the random numbers given will satisfy the, there is no correlation. There is no correlation. We can accept the numbers. So this completes the first chapter, that is a random number generation from the module 3. There is one more chapter, that is a random variate generation. Once I complete that, the entire module will be completed. Please go through this video. If you have any doubt, you can contact me back through the Google class. I wish you all the best. Thank you, everyone.